Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Hashtag Ask Jochen. For those of you who are new here, this is the live stream series that we do with Jochen Schleese. He's the founder of Schleese Saddlery, and he is a German certified master saddler. And this is the series that we do with him. We do this twice every month. And this particular episode, we do once per month, and we do just a Q&A. So we take your questions throughout the month, and then we bring them up to Jochen, and he answers them. We spend an hour together, and he kind of goes through your questions and answers some questions that we've gathered earlier, and then some questions that we do have live. So if you have questions and you're tuning in, feel free to drop them in the chat box, whether you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, and we will do as many questions as we can. We'll take as many questions as we can, and we are monitoring both chat boxes. So feel free to let us know where you're tuning in from, and if you do have any questions for Jochen, feel free to leave them there as well. So if you're new here, this is just a little bit of background on the screen of Jochen's history. And just because we are running a tiny teensy bit late, we're just going to move right on to our intro sequence, and then we'll welcome Jochen into the session today. That never gets old.
It never gets old, doesn't it?
Welcome, Jochen. Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure to be here. And I can see people are still looking for answers, no pun intended.
Always. Yeah, there seems to always be more questions. And we're really grateful to have this hour to kind of just sit down and talk about it, because there's so much to be discussed still. So.
Yes. So tell me how the connection is, because I haven't plugged in my Ethernet cable, but.
Oh, it seems to be working fine for me.
Okay. So if there's any problem, let me know.
Okay, will do. So we got a lot of. Likewise, our audience, if you guys experience any difficulties hearing or seeing us, please let us know in the chat box as well. Mm-hmm.
So your lady is doing pretty good, huh? I see a phenomenal posting on TikTok and Facebook and Instagram, and I saw this very funny Instagram post on the saddles giveaway. That was pretty well done.
Right. Yeah. They're doing little skits now. The marketing team. Yeah, we're starting this kind of funny, cheesy 90s kind of intro skit, which is really fun. So we've been having fun with it for sure.
Yeah. So people slept with their clothes, I guess, in the 90s.
Yeah, all sitcoms, people are fully dressed with their in bed. So yeah. Good. And we have some really cool series with Jochen actually coming up as well. So stay tuned for that. Yeah. Watching on our TikTok. It's going to be great.
Yeah, it was doing quite well with the little saddle we had there, huh?
Yeah, that first post was great. Yeah.
All right. So should I start?
Absolutely.
All right. As always, I like to do a little introduction for you folks who have seen this before. There is nothing new for all of you folks who are new. Welcome. We're excited that you choose to click in and see what we got to offer. Most of the time, people say there's so much to know and so much to learn. But the most confusing part, is everybody has a different opinion. You know, the oldest saying, you know, everybody has an opinion. And what should I believe? And I think what makes this session a little different, or our session a little bit different, is because we like to turn this around and look at from the horse side of view. You know, my horse, that was the first time I rode the German Championship as a three-day venting. And he was so honest. You know, he was always going, and no matter what problem was, until the problem was too late. We had team vets, we had chiropractors, we had everybody around us as competitors, and yet a lameness showed up, which nobody could explain where it comes from. We know where it was, but we could not detect where it came from. And that, I think, made me ask the question and I wanted to look for answers. And who am I going to get the answers from this or that company who sponsored me back then, or from this or that salesperson who sold a lot of saddles? So I decided to, obviously it's a horse saddle, an anatomy of the horse problem. So I decided to surround myself with professors, with veterinarians who took an oath, do no harm, to help these horses. And independent from what I did, they had their own studies concluded on saddle fitting. And it was fascinating how it all came back. The saddle has to function for a horse when it's in motion and not standing. Yet from all saddle fitters or saddle fitting schools, what was out there, they never really pay attention to watch the horse go under the saddle. They won't focus on what beautiful leather the saddle is made, or what, who is sponsored in that saddle, or how it looks on the horse's back in the cross ties. Yet in motion, we see a complete different picture. And that movement in the horse's back is what we're trying to fit without restricted with the saddle or cripple it. So, of course, I was delighted when I met these professors and these people who dedicated their work to the well-being of the horses. But that was just the tip of the iceberg. You know, then I came across top trainers and veterinarians who says, well, you know what also infects the back is the person who sits on top. How they sit on top, how they train the horse. And it's not just the movement of the horse you're trying to fit, and the saddle has to fit the horse, but it also has to fit the rider on top. You know, and then if you do a very good fitting to the horse, you do a very good fitting to the rider, there's still the aspect as what type of training method do they use? And all around the world, people ride and use horses for various things. But in the majority, we do it for pleasure. We don't need to win a war anymore. We do it for fun. Sure, there's one or the other person who says, hey, you know, I plow my field, or I ride to go and get the groceries. Very few. The majority do it for fun and as a pleasure. And once I continued on the research for the answers, I came across some wonderful veterinarians. And I did this all around the world in South America. Dr. Solange Miguel, who is an incredible wealth of knowledge, not only as a rider, as well as a chiropractic, has introduced Saddle Fit for Life. That's the educational arm from Schleese, or saddle manufacturing company. This philosophy from Saddle Fit for Life is now taught in several universities around the world, which is based on the anatomy of the horse, biomechanics, physiology, but also for the rider. So all these people who take the course are veterinarians or body workers. And then something interesting came across when I went to South Africa. I met a person who says, you know, if saddle fitting is so important, maybe I can win more races. Maybe I have less horses with nosebleed. Maybe I have less injuries. So once the racing industry got a hold of that, that was absolutely phenomenal what we could do for these horses to, well, last longer, win more. And then in the end, everybody's happy. The trainer, the owner, the jockey, the manager. If the equipment can help them to have less injuries, because as we know, racing is pretty severe. Also in South Africa, I met Dr. Catalina Thiersen, who has been working all around the world and has collected together with their partners a wonderful collection of horse skeleton, but they knew how the horse was ridden, what type of equipment they had. So they could very quickly say, oh, look at that. The deformity of the bone, the joints, the extra growth on the bone is not natural. That occurs when X, Y, Z. So we know fabulous. When the horse is dead, that saddle didn't fit or that training method wasn't correctly. But who wants to hear that? What about when do we know a horse is in pain and suffering? You know, we all know horses don't lie. Look at the eyes, the ears, the mouth. You know, so if I come on with one saddle I have to ride because my coach made me buy the saddle and the horse is just violent like this. And then I use another saddle my coach doesn't like because he or she doesn't get sponsored in it. I don't know. But the horse doesn't react at all. Maybe you need to listen to the horse. And one person who took it to the extreme is a very famous veterinarian. She and I worked together in England at a seminar, Dr. Sue Dyson. She wrote the ethogram on the horse, the facial expression for pain. And of course, we have a lot of behaviors across the globe who understand, that horse is in pain. So with all the expertise, what's out there, you know, even doctors who write books, how important it is that the saddle has to fit the rider first. Doctors who write a book, if a woman rides in a saddle that's designed for a male, in a Western saddle or English saddle, doesn't matter. If a woman rides in this wrong gender appropriate saddle, or man rides in the wrong appropriate saddle, he or she will compensate. And when you compensate as a rider, the horse will suffer pain. Now, this is not my words. This is something that hangs in Vienna, the Spanish riding school, what is taught since 400 years. And this director, he quoted this all the time at his duty from 1939 to 1964. It is the utmost important not to cause the pupil any discomfort. With a cramped posture, it is impossible to achieve a pliable seat. Without a pliable seat, it's not possible to oscillate in the horse's back. And if the back cannot oscillate, the horse will suffer pain and will not be able to collect. So there you got it. You know, very, very clear text for 400 years. If this back of the rider cannot swing comfortable, loose, back and forth without hitting the crotch, hurting the hip, the knee, then the partner, the horse will suffer pain. Now, once I learned all that, and I learned no matter how much instruction you take, no matter how much you put the horse in side reins, draw reins, whatever, the horse will have a hollow back if you sit not over your balance point. Shoulder, hips, and heels have to be in one line. The ball of the foot have to be in level with the sternum of the horse and the level of the sternum of the rider. Only then, only when you achieve that balance point, then the horse can move in harmony and will not suffer pain. We call and we talk about the standing seat. What that means is you sit on a horse as if you stand on the ground. The only difference is when you stand on the ground, your weight is on your feet. And if you sit on the horse in the standing seat, that means you still have the same posture and your legs are underneath you, but your weight is on your seat bones and not on the ball of the foot. And only then, when your ball of the foot aligns with the sternum of the horse and your sternum, you're in balance. Only when you have shoulder, hips, and heels in a perpendicular line, your horse has a chance to move comfortable, to carry you comfortable without causing any pain, because then the horse can oscillate and he can collect. Beautiful written long, long time ago, Xenophon wrote that it is impossible for you as a soldier to dodge the bullet, to get the horse to run faster, to last longer, if you don't correct train. And he was the first military officer who wrote this to his soldiers in black and white. The horse needs to oscillate, swing in his back. He needs to bring his back up in order to collect, which means the horse needs to be able to shift the weight off the forehand, get his haunches more underneath, and then he can carry not only himself, he's faster, he can spin, and he carry the rider much easier. If it's not happy because the rider doesn't fit, because I ignore the facial pain, the horse will compensate. Okay, the horse will give you some signs, but the long-term pain in today's horses is on the rise and we don't need it, right? So, and that's why we do this, what we do here. And my first book, Suffering and Pain, explains it very well, that is a combine of many things, like I showed you before, on the way the rider sits in the saddle, on the way the rider trains the horse, and of course, shoeing and nutrition is important too. So why do so many horses and riders suffer from ill-fitting saddles when all this technology, especially with social media, is online? Okay. Why do we have so many horses still in pain? Is it the ignorance, just based on opinion rather than on scientific facts, right? Or cognitive dissonance? I think it's a multiple factor which has changed a lot in the historical time of the horse. You know, we have different breeds. The horses are now mixed with each other. The horses are now used in different disciplines and not just for war. So the breeding changed. One of the top breeding experts in Germany is Barbara Schulte. She wrote this book, From Fluchttier zum Designerpferd. Fortunately, it's not in English, but she has many English videos. And she makes it very, very clear what changed so much on the design of the horse. Same with dogs, you know, German Shepherds who has all the hip dysplasia problems now. Horses what had a nice long back, broad shoulders, nice body for a purpose, you know, for plowing the field, for lasting, to be strong. To a horse, what is what we call designer horses, very narrow chest, long legs, hyperflexion, very short backs. And this is where I come in as a saddle maker. Says, oh, I used to have horses with long backs and I had a long weight bearing surface where I can distribute the weight. Now that is much shorter. Sure, you could say, just keep the saddle long and make weight bearing surface. Well, that would be the worst part, like you see on this saddle. Many saddles are way too long for today's horses. Okay, look at this. This is the circle of lights. Wherever you see this light, this is hit by the sun because the hair goes forward and here the hair goes back. You all who have groomed the horse know when you look at the hairline goes up and then it goes to this side and to this side and the light hits it. In the soldier's book, they always said, fold the blankets inside the saddle support area and never where the mane is and never in the ring of light, because underneath the ring of light you see right here are the spinal processes and these bones are very, very thin. So the horse will divot away, because before you do severe damage to this bone, the horse will go upside down. So now we have horses would get shorter. As a rider, the riding population gets heavier, taller. Then we have a huge change that used to be mainly male riders. Now you see the majority of the riders are women in English and Western. So no wonder there's so much confusion in the whole riding world. When it comes to horse owning, you know, in the end of the day, you're alone with your horse. You have this magic moment. You love him. You have fun with him. You groom him, you ride with him. The last thing is what you want is a saddle what interferes with your love, with your biomechanics, or with your anatomy or the horse's anatomy when you hurt the horse unintentionally. Okay. A good example is this female who rides in the male saddle. Okay. She was sponsored in the saddle. She had to ride in the saddle. She leans back because the saddle hits her in the crotch. She's grappling with the thighs. And the knees and toes are out and she's hard in the back and leaning back and the horse just trots pitiful out of the elbow. In this saddle, she sits in the saddle. It doesn't hurt her crotch. It doesn't hurt her hip. Her knees and ankles and hips are soft. Horse can oscillate. Look at how the horse trots out of the shoulder now, because only what changed, the rider becomes soft. That's what they talk about at the Spanish riding school. Look at the difference. Left, male saddle, right, female in the female saddle. It doesn't have to be magic. It's just common sense. common sense for who? For medical doctors who clearly understand there are nine different pelvic bone structures from male to female. Common sense for people who do biomechanics that if this structure is rigid and becomes like a jackhammer into the horse's back. Again, the majority of us, we love our horses, we want to have fun, and it should be easy. So what do I need to do? You know, so I always say, we have on the YouTube channel, we've done this seminar quite a bit back where we really explain in detail the big, big difference between a male and female saddle and the difference in the pelvises. And I encourage everybody, you know, so it doesn't matter if you ride racing, Western dressage or jumping. Fitting the saddle just means leaving you and the horse in a good state of mind without hurting yourself long term. And that's pretty much it.
Awesome intro, as always, Jochen. Yeah, that was a really great live stream that we did. I think it was April, or like it was a while ago, but it was very well done, and definitely highly recommend anybody to go and check that out.
That was April last year.
No. Yeah, it was a long time
ago. That was April last year.
Reiterate it.
Yeah, I mean, here's a good picture where we show all the different points, you know, which are completely the opposite, male pelvis versus female pelvis. From a saddle maker or retailer or saddle fitter or whoever works with saddles, it makes no difference in cost. But for the rider, mm-hmm. you know, I can only imagine, I want to see a very good cowboy or a male rider riding in female underwear. You know, everybody would laugh and chuckle and says, well, that's just cloth. We're dealing here with wood trees, carbon fiber trees, with leather, with foam, and that's not as soft as cloth. Right. So
exactly.
My recommendation, really, really, if you're looking for a saddle fit, start with yourself. I mean, these are just very basic measurements. Binga, banga, bonga, five measurements, fill it in, and then you know how that relates to your saddle. And that's pretty much what we do at Schleese. We measure you, and then we compare how it fits you, saddle fit to rider, before we even put it on the horse. And that's my first advice to everybody. And not just as a judge or as a coach or as a trainer, you know, if I can't get my rider to be in balance, in harmony, why do we even bother with anything else?
Right. And we have a really excellent online program as well for anyone who's interested in really learning the ins and outs of our measuring process and getting to have a more hands-on approach. It's a fantastic online program where we essentially teach you how to take the measurements, and then you submit all your measurements to us, and we do a video call with you and discuss our findings. So it's a really excellent online program available on our website.
Mary Claire, we had also a live stream once done. I don't have a Western saddle or Western inserts here, but don't we have a live stream done once where we have, and I used my wife for this, where we played around with these different inserts to
we
see
yeah.
what different it makes, because on our Western saddle, it has the ability that you could change it in no time from a male to a female saddle. And of course, males are different from one male to the other, weight, height, hip size, etc. And the shape of the bottom, and the same with women. That's why sometimes a combination of one or two inserts is the right fit. But that's maybe something we might want to, because that's a question that comes up a lot, you know, how do I use my inserts and stuff like this?
Right.
That live stream would be a great demonstration, I think.
Definitely. And I believe we also have a Devon demo video that you've done right when the Devon came out. So it was just a video of you actually discussing the saddle and taking it apart and discussing all the inserts as well. So that's a really helpful video to anyone who's looking for that information. So mm-hmm. I'll definitely be reposting that on social media very soon to kind of help people out that way. But other than that, should we move on to the questions now, Jochen?
Of course, of course.
Awesome. Well, great introduction as always. And so the first question we have today is, can you please talk about the 3P gullet plate and explain what makes it different from other gullet plates?
Okay. So when we talk about gullet plate, a gullet plate is this metal reinforced bracket, what is sitting over the horse's withers. And the reason why there is a bracket, without that bracket, you either have a fiberglass tree, carbon fiber tree, rawhide tree, wood tree, plastic tree, something what doesn't give. If you have a saddle what gives, like a wood spring tree, flex tree, adapt tree, binate tree, so these are all type of saddle trees where the movement in the horse's back gets through. So in order not to crush the horse's withers, those saddles have a gullet plate. And these gullet plates, some companies, you can take it out by taking the screw here. There's a hole there and a hole there. And then you can exchange these gullet plates, and they come in different sizes. The 3P gullet plate stands for 3-point gullet plate adjustment. And then the question comes, of course, why do we need to have 3 points to adjust it? Is 3 points mean narrow, medium, wide? No, that's just the angle. And when I say angle, it's when I bring this here and I measure the radius here, that gives me the angle. And that can come in various shapes and angles. When I talk the width, that would be how big the arc is of that metal plate. The low part here, the lower part of the gullet plate, is in the same area where the horse's scapula is. When the horse moves, it pushes the upper arm, the leg goes forward, that elbow pushes the upper arm up, and that scapula rotates like a piston, not just up and down, but also backwards, sort of like a circle. There's many, many animation, many, many videos where you can see how this works. So the angle is absolutely important so you don't clip the shoulder and you let that shoulder, when the leg goes forward, standing, forward, extending, that slides through it. If it doesn't fit in the angle, it will pinch the cartilage. Maybe you can look in this video here. If you look at that, boom, it comes back. It's very, very hard to see, but I let it run for a while. Watch this, boom, it came back. Watch this, boom. Okay, so it moves back when the horse moves. And you see also muscle contracting here and so on and so forth. So that's one adjustment. So one point of the 3-point adjustment, we call it the angle of the gullet plate. So a few of the companies have plates you can change them, the interchangeable gullet plate. So they change the angle. So what if the horse becomes more mature? What if the horse gets a wider shoulder muscle? So in other words, from this side to this side, all of a sudden it gets wider. You have the angle of the shoulder blade, okay? It becomes steeper, so more mature and so stronger they get. And then look at the distance from the top of the plate, left and right, versus while the horse matures. So that's the tree width, or the gullet plate width, right there. Okay, so I mentioned earlier, that's how big the arc is. So to make it as simple as possible, we call it the tree width, D-ring, between D-ring and D-ring. I have a drawing I'm going to look for it so you can see the big, big difference between the, angle and the tree width. So give me a minute to find that, because that is pretty much easy to understand when you look at from that point of view. I have it also in my book, and that's very often for many people, I never knew that. Well, if you look at this diagram here, horses do become wider in the shoulder. just making it wider in the angle, you only going to clip the top of the shoulder. And that's what we see all the time when we look at the thermography or we look at the bone structure where the horses got clipped on the shoulder. And for me, that's an absolutely important part that every saddle fitter, saddle company, rider owner should know. Angle does not equal tree width. And as usual, when you look for something very fast, you don't see it. So give me one more minute. I give it one more shot. If not, I'm going to show you on the saddle itself. So maybe, Mary Claire, you can talk in the meantime about the saddle giveaway.
For sure. For those of you who are tuning in and who are new to our live stream, we do a saddle giveaway yearly. And if you'd like to enter, the link is on our pinned top pinned Facebook post on our Facebook page. So just head over to our Facebook page and you should be able to click that link. If you're experiencing any kind of technical difficulties, because occasionally that will happen, please feel free to email me directly or email us at info@schleese.com. And someone will definitely assist you with that. And but definitely take advantage of it. We give away a saddle a year and we draw the winner on December 31st.
Thank you. That gave me enough time to look at this picture.
Perfect.
So here, wherever the vertical panel starts, it's most of the time where the D-ring is on your saddle or on the Western saddle where your bar starts. The distance where your bar starts or the vertical panel on the English saddle starts, that we call the tree width. Okay, anything below, that's the tree angle. So here you can see this is very, very wide. Okay, look at the space between the withers and that D-ring. Okay, and now let's focus on the bottom part. Okay, see how steep that is? That's not the same angle as this. Here the opposite, this is digging in and it's flaring out on the bottom. So left to right is too narrow. This is perfect, because it's parallel with the shoulders, but there's a little gap here where it doesn't dig in and it's not as far away as that. Here's the diagram I was talking about. Look at the red lines. They're all at the same degrees, but the distance between the D-ring, see, it's all different. Narrow tree width, medium, wide tree width. Here we have the opposite, all the same distance between the D-ring. The tree width is the same, but look at the angle. See that? Steep, normal, wide. So different width. So that's the second part on the three-point gullet plate. What adjusts the tree? Right now, there is no other gullet plate on the market where the rider, with or without a professional help, can adjust that saddle in the tree width, independent from the tree angle, without, this is the best part, without twisting or damaging the saddle. You need no special machines to do it. So this is the number two on the gullet plate. Here's the picture of a saddle. You can see how the saddle falls to the right. Look how the stirrup leather is lower on the right versus on the left. Okay, so the rider clearly hangs to one side. And from 10 riders, you see at least six, if not seven riders where the saddle gets pushed over to one side. Does that mean more than 60% horses are lame? Well, some veterinarian says 84% of horses be right are lame. So is the falling to the right because the horse is lame? Some people believe so. Some people call it behavior, like I got out of that slide here. And some people say, just like humans, horses are not machines and not machine grind totally even, which means this is the ribcage of the horse, the serratus, the muscle where the ribcage hangs off the shoulder blade, the upper arm, the lower arm, the shoulder blade. One out of 10 horses are 100% symmetric. Seven out of them look like this. Look at this upper arm, look at this. Compare the two different humerus, look at the muscle structure. The problem is we cannot tell until the horse is dead. If this horse here on the right, you see how much bigger it's on the left versus on the right. We do not know if this is only muscular. Is it only bad shoeing? bad training, or is it structural? Why do we not know? Because you can't x-ray the upper arm. That means they need to jam a plate between the chest, which I can't do. MRI, there's not enough tube where they can put the whole horse through it. So when I ride, before my farrier comes, osteopath, chiropractor, physiotherapist, special training, if I do not address this in the fitting, that gullet plate will be hitting this shoulder first when the shoulder comes back. And 7 out of 10 styles goes to that side. So the third adjustment on the 3-point gullet plate is you can actually open, when you have a horse like that, that side a little bit bigger so your saddle does not twist horrible to one side. Now you could say, yeah, it's a rider error, okay? But what if all the riders who ride this particular saddle and horse fall to the right? What if it's a horse what normally wins, but the rider over the jump always sits severely to one side? Start looking jumping horses from the front and you will not believe how many riders kick their left leg out because the saddle is twisting to the right. Okay, it's a common picture. This is why we wanted to have a gullet plate what can be adjusted in 3 points, hence the word 3-point gullet plate, in the tree width, tree angle, and 4, asymmetric in the horse. So if it's level again, if it's through training, through riding, etc., whatever, okay, if the horse becomes level, I can easily go to the number, so it's absolutely symmetric. That's a 3-point gullet plate.
Excellent. Thank you, Jochen. We did have a couple questions that we've just gotten live, and I'm wondering if we could tackle them before we move on to the other questions. So the first question comes from Janine Callahan on Facebook, and she's asking, what's the difference between the Devon and the Cadence Western saddles?
Okay, so when we started to make saddles, myself as a, well, event riders, I only wanted to make jumping saddles or eventing saddles. But we had many, many people from all around the world who says, we need you to make dressage saddles. Fine, we make dressage saddles. And then it became one thing to the next. And that was pretty much our main industry until somebody says, you said you wanted to make a big difference to the horse community. You want to help all the horses. You should make Western saddles as well. And then when we looked into Western saddles, I came together with many Western manufacturers, in not only in North America and in Canada or in the States, to see if they want to adapt the Saddle Fit for Life philosophy, which is based on the anatomy of the horse and rider. And it was really, really hard to convince old-fashioned saddle making. So he says, okay, then we have to make the Western saddle. And then we decided to start with one, which was the Devon. The Devon is made after market research. What are the most Western riders doing? Are they still going for 3, 4, 6 months out into the hillside and drive cattles? Or what do they do? Most people are pleasure riders, trail riders. So we decided to do this. Then cowboy dressage came on. Cowboy dressage or Western dressage became very, very popular. And we wanted to have a saddle where they can do cowboy dressage, where they ride with a saddle what looks Western, but it is a little bit more flexible. The fenders look a little bit different and it has a more traditional look. The first one, the Devon, is more a trail saddle, where the other saddle, Mary Claire, what was the name again? I draw a blank right now.
The Cadence?
Cadence, yes.
There's so many saddle names.
I know. was strictly made for the cowboy or Western dressage.
Excellent. Thank you, Jochen. The next question we have here is from DTV Calgary on YouTube. And they ask, as an endurance rider, what saddle would you recommend?
Well, we have over the time made so many English saddles, and I never understood why Western people ride Western saddles as endurance riders. once we started with computerized saddle pad, gait analysis, thermography, I saw, wow, a Western saddle has so much more weight-bearing surface than a very good fitted English saddle. Then we have endurance riders. I don't want to ride with the Western saddle. It's too heavy. It's too big. Even our lightweight saddle was too big. So what was very quick notice that certain features of a saddle on the Western was very, very in demand and was best for the horse, but was not good for the rider. So we said, okay, we need to have some kind of a hybrid. And then we noticed some people don't like leather. Some people like more D-rings than other people. Some people don't even like flaps. And I find that an endurance saddle is very individual based. For me, number one, it gotta be gender appropriate. Because if the rider compensates and gets crampy and stiff, the horse will feel it. So, and obviously we can do it in the Western and English. Then weight is a big, big factor. And I wanted something what is almost like a treeless saddle, what follows the shape, but yet distributes the rider's weight over the horse's back. So the most endurance saddles, what I work with people who ride endurance, was based on an English saddle with a Western bottom, call it a hybrid. And some of them wanted to do the padding themselves with shim pads. Other people wanted to have sheepskin, wool felt, but the majority wanted a light saddle with many D-rings in an English saddle, but it's super flexible and gives really with the movement of the horse. Let's face it, in the first 25 miles, the horse's back is relatively straight. And then the next 50 miles, the back is a little lower. So the curvature of the tree plays a huge role. You don't get that in the Western saddle, that it follows the long front to back curvature in the horse's back like a super adaptable English tree will do. And that's why we call our saddle trees adapt tree.
Wonderful. Thank you, Jochen. We have one more live question we'll take before we move on to our other questions that we have gathered over the month. But we always like to reward people who are tuning in live. So we're taking this question from Louise Levesque on YouTube, and she's asking, how can we tell at first sight if a Western saddle is a female or male saddle?
Okay, so as we were looking at posture, okay, and we were talking about the difference between male and female. The girl has more arc in her lower back and a shorter tailbone than the male. On the male Western saddle, you have a big pocket here. It's a big cutout. And that big cutout is there because your buttocks on the guy and your tailbone is way lower than on the female. Due to the fact that the curvature of the lady is so much stronger in average than the male, the lady's buttock sits higher and the tailbone, due to the fact of the, well, birth channel, is lower. So what we did, we put two people, different sex, same height, just one boy, one girl, and put them in a plaster Paris and in one of the casts. And what we find out, once they were sitting in it, that the girl hits first here. The guy has a cut up here, which means a rooftop. So on the Western saddle, typical, this area is built up to a point. So his male parts go left to right. So when you sit in the Western saddle on the stand or on the horse, and you feel the crotch first, it's built in there for the guy so that he doesn't fall on his soft parts. On a female, absolute, because this is where the bone of your pelvis hits first, okay? This bone here, the pubic symphysis, is the first you hit. Look where that bone is on the rider, on the male. Way up there, way up there. And then we can put our parts left or right, ladies can't. So on the female Western saddle, there would be a hollow. Then the skirt, or the jockeys, they call them on the Western saddles, the side parts here where the goes over the side, they would be stitched very low because the female has a wider seat bone than a male. Again, birth channel. Same as in English saddle or Western saddle. On the female, you hit first this. On the male, we have the space. And there is less distance between my tailbone and my butt cheeks in the back. So how do I tell if I sit in a Western saddle, which is made for a male or female? A male has a hole here in the back, has a point in the crotch, and is relatively wide in the thigh. If a female sits on the Western female saddle, there would be more support here. There would be a hole in the crotch area. You would never feel the seam on the jeans. And your hip will not hurt, and your leg falls right underneath you, comfortable without being jerked apart, because that's a very common problem. Because on the male, we have more space between our thighs, females don't. Before your sciatic nerve, what runs on your inner thigh, gets pinched, you want to rotate your hip out and you'll feel it in riding on your hip. Okay, so your only excuse is Western or English, you can ride like this. Roll your toes out, leg goes forward. And now you're not sitting secure anymore. You're sitting heavy into the horse's loins and you bounce around, and the horse does not like that. And neither does your bones. So if you say, I got strong bones, your nerve will play a trick on you. You will get sciatic nerve, lower back pain, and knee. Now, these are not my pictures. These are pictures you get from medical doctors who've written about what can happen to a body if we ride deformed in a saddle. I call that deformed, okay? Because that lady tries to don't hit her crotch, and so she scoops back and lifts the heel and toes, okay? Okay, so a male wants the pointy roof. The lady sits on the pointy roof, hits her crotch. So for me, if you have a little child, or even as an adult, you put yourself in shoes which deform your toes and your bone or your foot gets deformed. And that's what happens to your lower back. Okay, your disc collapse slips first, of course, because you cannot avoid the damage you get from the front. So good picture here again, the difference on the male pelvis from the side, how long the tailbone is, how straight the lower back is. A very long-winded answer to a very good question, because that's how you can recognize if a Western saddle is made for a male versus for a female.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Jochen. Yeah, that question comes up in a lot of different ways, but it's such a great, it's so great to see it visually demonstrated in the way that you just did. And it's very helpful. So thank you.
And it's so cool too. You know, we all buy shoes and jackets and pants. And when we try it, you slide in and it says, oh, that's comfortable. That's what I buy. And this is the beautiful part with saddles. Mm-hmm. I recommend every single rider, when you buy saddles, always get the same model in the male and the female version. So you get that feel. You don't need to buy something only to find out 4 or 5 months or years later, you bought the complete wrong product. Always try both models, male or female, and then you instantly, your subconscious mind will tell you, boom, I'm happy here.
Yeah. And even just looking at the pelvises, it just makes sense, you know, like it, like to learn about all of this and to have actually the knowledge behind the reasoning of why you're getting a female saddle. Like look at the difference. It's obvious, right? So
well, why do you think so many saddle makers or fitters don't believe on that?
Out of convenience to them.
Can you elaborate that a little bit more?
Like maybe it's easier for them to just sell you a product that will inevitably make you have to kind of come back to them for another product, or it might be easier for them to just create one type of product to sell in a lot of different ways.
Do you think there are stores where you can only buy female shoes?
A lot less, I'd say.
Or female clothes?
Yes, definitely.
Are there stores where you can buy female clothes or male clothes or male shoes?
Yes, but I'd say less than women. but
they're isolated stores, right?
Right, yeah.
That does exist.
Yes.
And there's, of course, stores where you can buy both, right? Shoes or clothes for male and for female.
Right.
And that's exactly in the tack shop or in the saddle industry. Some people concentrate only on one gender. Other people concentrate on both. And no reason and no wonder why when you go in the tax shop today, the majority of the tax shops concentrate mainly on the people who buy the most clothes or the most women. Why would I buy tons and tons of male breeches if my customers are 95% women?
Right.
But in the saddle industry, you hit the nail, you know, and it's also the fact that people don't know what they don't know. And maybe the patterns, the tree designs, the molds, the problematic fit, what it's now, not just for me, for many, many international veterinarians online, you know, you can't deny it anymore. You know, the behavior problems, veterinarians who have articles and saddle fitting, totally independent what I say. So in my opinion, Mary Claire, it's just, they don't know what they don't know, or
right.
We trying to live with the thought the earth is flat and not round.
Mm-hmm. Cognitive dissonance.
There you go. You took the word out of my mouth, but this is what it is. And that's not what we make up.
Right. And I think it's really obvious when you use like the butt casts and stuff like that. It makes a lot of sense. And it's a really great way to illustrate. So on behalf of everyone, thank you. Just before we move on, I'd say we can fit in like maybe one last question. But before we move on, I just want to read this comment because we received a really nice comment on Facebook just now from Mary Ann McPherson. She says, I had the opportunity to ride in your new adjustable saddles, the Continuum and the Sequence. I love the concept of the three-piece gullet plate and shoulder adjustability and how fast and easy it was to have it fitted to my big shouldered Frisian horse. So I just thought that was a really nice comment and a really nice thing to bring up. But moving on to our last question of the evening. Let's see what Jochen can answer in 5 minutes. What kind of saddle would you recommend for a horse with a very short saddle support area?
Definitely a saddle what has a very, very short pommel. And when I say pommel, is the rise of the front of the saddle is what I feel as a rider, that point right there. But then anything from that point on forward, okay, there comes 5 different sizes, okay? The worst thing you can do is buying a full cutback or a 5-inch full cutback. That means from this point forward, you have 5-inch more forward saddle, which does make no difference to your seat size. It just increases the length of the entire saddle for weight-bearing surface. So if you are a very heavy man on a very big horse, hopefully, you will have a saddle which has a lot of saddle in front of you for weight-bearing surface. If you're a person who has a horse which has a very short back, okay, then you want a saddle with a short pommel, number one. Number two, definitely get as that's the pommel right there. Okay, you want something very short. This is too long right here. The saddle needs to finish here. Makes no difference to you. The flap would go with the angle of the leg, but this here is for short. Then you want something what is sweeping up in the back. Saddles have different panel wedges. They can come out to the side. They can have very steep angles, very flat angles, or they can go to the rear. Okay, the elongation. So see that dotted line? You want to have a panel. They call them French panel, banana panel, roll-up panels, or relief panels. You want something. Your butt is hopefully where my mouse is and not on top of the cantle. So well before the panel ends. Okay. But you don't need an extender in the back because your horse's back is not that long. Okay. You just need to think about when my skeleton comes down, I need to stay behind the shoulder and in front of the lumbar. So I keep a short pommel, the tree points curving back, so rear facing tree points, and a swept up panel, a French panel, banana panel, or relief panel. That's what is very often referred to the back of here. You only feel this, pommel to cantle. How long the panel is in the back makes no difference to you. How the panels, you see this little curve cut out in the front, how this is curled back in the front, makes no difference to you. How much saddle is in front, makes no difference to you. That is for the horse. That's how you, or we recommend you should have a saddle what fits a short back horse.
Excellent. Thank you, Jochen. That was a really, really clear demonstration of that. I'd like to just wrap this up by thanking everybody who's been tuning in. We've seen a lot of new faces or new names this week, and I'd just like to welcome you all. We do this twice a month. We do one Q&A and one live stream lecture. So feel free to tune back in for our next session. And on behalf of everyone tuning in, I'd just like to thank Jochen for your time, for his time. We always really appreciate sitting down and getting our questions answered. And so
you're very welcome. When is our next one? Because in October, I'm pretty much gone, am I? Yeah.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, you're away in you're away for the rest of the month, but we will have our live stream lecture while you're in Florida. So our lecture is the next one, and it'll be fine. So it'll be after your session.
I got you. Okay, yeah. I'm in California, by the way.
In California. Sorry, I think by the time we have our live stream lecture, it'll be Florida likely.
Oh, that's right.
Right. Yeah. So So have a great time in California and safe travels.
Thank you.
And thank you, Jochen. Thanks for your time. Thank you, everybody.